Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present The Scavengers by Michael Perry. Narrated by Sandy Rustin.
Introduction. The old car was sunk to the bumpers when I discovered it. But my first thought was how good it would be to sleep in there and hear the rain drumming on steel rather than splattering against our tattered old tarp. I was Maggie back then. Maggie, the name my parents gave me. A nice name, but these weren't nice times. We were tired and hungry, and the gray devil bonfires were burning brighter, and the solar bear howls were getting closer. And every morning, as I strapped my spit stick across my back and set out to scavenge, I found myself thinking I needed a better name, a stronger name. I mean, the name Maggie was fine. It just seemed kinda underpowered. So when I scrubbed the moss from the side of that old car overlooking Gold Mine Gully and saw the chrome letters Ford Falcon, I climbed up on the hood and stood there with my steel-toed boots planted wide, and I wedged my fists on my hips, and I announced that Maggie was yesterday, and from this day forward, I would answer only to Ford Falcon. Ford, because we had a lot of rivers to cross. Falcon, because, well, if you have a lot of rivers to cross, a pair of wings can't hurt. And then once you get across the river, it's likely you will need sharp eyes and an even sharper beak. Yes, I know. I named myself after an old, dead car. Worse yet, it's not even a cool car. It's a station wagon. Station wagons were how parents hauled kids around during the time between covered wagons and minivans. These days, you won't see a minivan unless it's being pulled by a horse, and even horses are hard to come by. But if you see me, you will know me because I wear a vest made from the hide of a beast that tried to kill me and lost. I skinned that beast myself, and also, I skinned the lettering from that old, dead car and stitched it to the vest across my shoulder blades using copper wire, so that in polished chrome the world can read my name and know it. Ford Falcon. Chapter 1.
Cock-a-doodle! Ack-ack-ack-ack!
Way down in Hoot Holler, Hatchet, the rooster, is ruling the roost. It's tough to rule the roost when all of your cock-a-doodles sputter out like you're gagging on a crossways caterpillar. But Hatchet's ego is twice the size of his multicolored mop of a tail, and I guarantee you by the time that last cack echoes off Skullduggery Ridge, he's already fluffing his feathers and strutting around like that's exactly what he meant to say.
Cock! Ack, 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 ack.
Hatchet belongs to our neighbors, Toad and Arlinda Hopper. They live a half-hour hike away, down the western side of Skullduggery Ridge. But even though we can't see their farm from here, the crowing comes through loud and clear. That rooster has brass lungs, and once he gets started, he doesn't stop. He'll crow at noon. He'll crow at the moon. He'll crow any which way the wind blows. Most of all, he'll crow whenever he feels the need to remind the world that he is a rooster, which is about every 6 minutes. That bird is as loopy as a ball of snarled yarn.
Cock-a-doodle! Ack-ack-ack-ack!
Guess I'm done sleeping. I crawl out of the station wagon and climb onto the hood. Dawn is still a ways off. But even as I pull my quilt tight around my shoulders, birds are twittering in the darkness around me. That is, when they aren't drowned out by all the cock-a-doodle-acking. On the horizon before me, there are two faint gray smudges of light. One is the first hint of sunrise. The other is the glow from the lights of a bubble city. I've never been to any of the bubble cities, but once when I was helping Toad tear apart a junk car, I found a brochure under the back seat that said, "Your Bubble City." Inside it had a lot of pictures of happy people laughing and playing volleyball and eating ice cream cones. The brochure unfolded like a map to show more happy people doing more happy things, swimming, dancing, walking through flowers, laughing on rides in an amusement park, jumping on trampolines. Toad had to explain to me what volleyball, amusement parks, and trampolines were. And when it was all the way unfolded, you could see a shiny bubble shimmering above all the people. I told Toad it looked pretty neat. He just shook his head and said something about not believing everything I read. As the gray horizon oozes over to pink, the glow of the bubble city fades and the landscape takes shape, sloping sharply away to the east from the Falcon's front bumper before rumpling itself into foothills that bump along for many miles into the invisible distance. I wonder sometimes what my life would be like if Dad and Ma had stayed under bubble, as everyone out here calls it. Instead, they chose out bubble. And believe me, there is no volleyball or ice cream cones out bubble. As the last of the glow disappears into sunlight, I wonder if there are girls my age waking beneath the bubble and what their day will be like compared to mine. Now the parrot flocks are squawking. This makes me grin because it means Hatchet is getting some competition. Dad and Ma tell me there never used to be parrots here unless they were in cages. Now they swoop around all over the place. My parents say the world has changed a lot since they were children. Back then, people argued about whether the earth was warming up or cooling down. Well, the weather did get warmer. We don't really have winter anymore. But mostly it just got weirder. The seasons are all skittery. Sun for a month, then sleet for a week. Snow drifts on Tuesday, puddles on Wednesday. Our oak and pine forests got more jungly and leafy. The parrots moved in, and other newcomers followed. Wild hogs, alligators halfway up the Mississippi, sky-blocking flocks of turkey vultures, and, scariest of all, solar bears. Solar bears were created when government scientists tried to save polar bears from extinction by crossing them with grizzly bears and splicing in a dab of coyote DNA. The result wasn't really a polar bear or a grizzly bear, but a four-legged experiment with white fur and caramel-colored stripes, big teeth and bad breath, and a howl like its tail is caught in a crack. One thing the scientists maybe hadn't kept in mind is that bears can range hundreds of miles. So after the weather changed, it wasn't long before they migrated down into this area. There is a reason I never go anywhere without my hunting knife, my spit stick, my tooth club, and a sack of pepper pea pellets. I made all of those weapons myself, and they're on the car hood beside me this very minute. Well, except for the knife, which was given to me by Toad, and I carry sheathed in my boot top. The sun is nearly up now. In the lower valleys, I can see smeary patches of smoke drifting from the last of the Grey Devil bonfires. Nobody really knows where the Grey Devils come from, but we'd all be happier if they went back. Toad says they probably started out as humans, like us, and that's why we should try not to kill them. But they're pale and dirty, and instead of talking, they moan and howl like sickly solar bears. Creepy. Every night they build big bonfires of whatever trash and wood they can find, and then gather around to get all hopped up on parts wash. Parts wash is homemade hooch. It's fermenty and disgusting, and got its name because it smells like something a mechanic would use to strip grease from old engine parts. Plus, based on the way the Grey Devils look, If you drink it long enough, it'll pretty much wash away your parts. Parts wash is brewed by gangs we call juice cruisers. The gray devils steal anything they can lay their hands on and trade it to the juice cruisers for parts wash. Then, the juice cruisers turn around and trade and sell the stolen things wherever there is a market, which is pretty much everywhere, because these days, here in Outbubble World, there's a shortage of everything. I've never met a juice cruiser and never hope to. Toad says they are outlaws who will leave you alone if you leave them alone. I don't know exactly what the juice cruisers put in parts wash, but it must be powerful because the gray devils will do pretty much anything to get more, which is why they're dangerous, at least until evening when they start drinking. The bonfires burn all night long until the parts wash is gone or the last gray devil has collapsed. From up here, the countryside looks all soft and gentle and newborn. But those smoke smears remind me that this is not paradise.
Cock-a-doodle-ack-ack-ack-ack!
Also, there is that rooster. No sound like that would ever be allowed in paradise. Uphill from where I am sitting, I hear a noise. I turn to look and see Ma step out of the shack with her pans, ready to cook breakfast. It's time to begin the day. Chapter 2. We are a family of four. There's me, of course. I'm at that age where I'm not sure who I am. But then again, in the world we live in, there isn't a lot of time to wonder. Mostly we are busy scavenging, scrounging, and surviving. It's not like I have a lot of time to sit around thinking in cutesy, heart-dotted curlicue letters. I love my family, but I choose to live in an old car 100 yards downhill from them. Maybe that tells you something. My first chore every morning is to let the chickens out and gather eggs for breakfast. The path takes me right past our outdoor oven, which is made from mud and stones. Ma is stoking the fire.
Morning, Ma.
Good morning, Maggie. Ma refuses to call me Ford Falcon. She also refuses to say morning. She is precise about these things. When we drop our gerunds, we drop our standards, she likes to say. Ma studied English and writing in college. To me, gerund sounds like the name of a teensy African antelope, but it really means the ing sound at the end of a word. Just because our life is rough around the edges doesn't mean we have to be rough around the edges, says Ma. I still like to say morning. The chicken coop is small, square, and solid. Before I open the people door, I drop a tiny drawbridge hatch, and the chickens come clucking and blinking out into the daylight. I never get tired of watching them go flapping into freedom, fanning out to peck and scratch, and turn their head sideways to give a bug the beady eye before snapping it into their beaks. Our flock is all hens, no roosters. One hatchet is rooster enough for miles around. Inside the coop, I wait a moment for my eyes to adjust to the dimness, then reach into the nesting boxes one by one. The eggs are still warm, and I like the way each one feels in my palm. Solid and delicate at the same time. Some of the eggs are white, some of the eggs are brown, and some are pale green. They all look the same in the frying pan. I am placing the last egg in the basket when I hear a noise behind me. Just as I turn to check it out, a figure leaps from the darkest corner of the coop and into my face.
Flabbershammy!
The eggs go everywhere. My heart is flopping like an electrocuted fish.
Dookie!
I yell. But the little creature has already scooted out the door and is running off to Ma, flapping his arms like chicken wings. Dookie. My little snot flicker of a brother. He drives me nuts. Always popping up here and there, scaring the bejeebers out of me. Grabbing one of the unbroken eggs, I sidearm it out the door and it smacks him. Pop, shmush, on the back of his head.
Zabazoo!
He hollers and leaps into Ma's arms.
Maggie!
Now it's Ma hollering. She's holding Dookie, and he's looking up at her with his sad pony eyes. Dookie has never been able to speak with his mouth, but he figured out how to talk with those eyes a long time ago.
Ma, he... Enough, says Ma.
Right about then, she runs her hand through his hair and discovers the egg goop.
For shame, both of you!
She sets Dookie down, and now he's looking at me, and his eyes have changed from sad pony to sneaky weasel. While I gather up the remaining eggs, Ma goes back to cooking the bacon, and Dookie goes spinning off in circles, humming to himself. Dookie has never been right. I love him, but I love him the way you always love stinky little brothers. A little bit goes a long way. I know it bothers Ma that he can't talk the way he should, but there's nothing to be done. And he seems happy enough, as long as he gets to drive his sister up a tree now and then. I hand Ma the surviving eggs. As she cracks them into the pan, I turn to get the dishes from the shack and meet the fourth member of our family, Dad, coming out the door. He blinks as he steps into the open, then rubs his eyes slowly. Dad was always an early riser, but lately he sleeps in more often. Sometimes when he comes out of the shack, he looks like he didn't sleep at all. Ma gives him a worried look she thinks I don't see. Dad hugs her. Dookie leaps out of the bushes and hugs them both.
Morning, Dad, I say.
Oh, morning, says Dad, like he just noticed me.
When the eggs are done, Ma serves Dookie first. He takes a mouthful, stands up, spins in a circle, then sits down and does the same thing again. This is not unusual. This is just your basic breakfast with Dookie. We're used to it. Before Ma hands Dad his plate, she chops up a wild garlic plant and sprinkles it over the eggs. I wrinkle my nose. Dad eats garlic on everything. He says it helps him stay healthy. I say it just makes him smell funny. But by the time he's halfway through his eggs, he does seem better.
You ready to hunt for gold?
He asks me, smiling in his lopsided way. Chapter 3. I once lived in a regular house with regular people in a regular place. I remember cars and television screens and telephones and green grass and at least one birthday cake. Most of my memories from those days are gone or blurry. But one memory I carry as clearly as if it happened yesterday. I am standing in a field with my father. He is holding a red balloon. There is a white bandage on his cheek. He kneels down to hand me the balloon, but he lets go too quickly, and the string slips through my fingers. The balloon rises, sliding sideways across the sky, higher and higher until it is a colorless dot that I can't see anyway because I am crying. Dad takes me into the house and blows up another red balloon. But when he lets go of this one, it doesn't float. It just drops to the floor with a soft bounce and sits there. I stomp on it and make it pop. And then I remember we got into a car that smelled brand new and drove into the country. Dad said we were going camping. And I was excited, but Ma was crying. Dookie was just a little bundle in his car seat. We drove for almost a whole day. I remember the radio was on, and right when it was starting to get dark, I heard a man on the radio talking about a red balloon, which made me grumpy again. And then, right after that, Dad stopped the car and said it was time to start the camping trip. It wasn't a very good camping trip. Mostly, I remember rain and walking, and walking, and walking, day after day. I remember being cold and damp in the mornings, and hot and hungry in the afternoons. I remember bug bites, and scrapes, and itching,
and blisters and the sound of howling solar bears. I remember Dad's white bandage turning brown from dust and sweat. I remember eating cold beans from cans. And then one day, I remember Dad telling me we would be camping for a very long time. I remember yelling at Dad and running to Ma, and both of us crying while she held me. I remember Dad standing there with a pack on his back and Dookie strapped on his front, and I remember Dad had tears in his eyes too. Dookie just blew bubbles through his drool. In the beginning, at least we had a tent. But one night in an awful storm, a tree branch blew down, ripping through the tent and stabbing the ground right beside my head. The next day, Dad found an old tarp snagged in the brush beside a flooded stream, and that became our shelter. By then, we were out of canned food and scrounging for whatever we could find, like cattail roots and green apples and Dad's precious wild garlic. Sometimes Dad was able to kill a rabbit or a squirrel, and we fried the meat over a fire. And we were always searching for water. I remember begging Dad to take us back home. He just very quietly said, "We can't do that, Maggie." And when I begged Ma, she said the same thing, even more quietly. When I asked why, they looked at each other, and then Dad said someday I would understand. And so we stayed hidden in the woods, rolling up that tarp and moving every few days. The days became weeks, the weeks became months. Ma did everything she could to give me little moments of a normal life. We played games like tic-tac-toe and connect the dots. She sang songs to Dookie. She read to me from a book called Little House on the Prairie. Ma said no matter how we were living, she couldn't imagine her daughter being in a world without books, so she had slipped it in her pack at the last minute. We read that book over and over until I had every chapter memorized. Every time I heard about the hardships little Laura Ingalls and her family went through, it helped me a little bit with understanding ours. Ma said I should learn to read, too, and she began teaching me the alphabet. We didn't have a blackboard or pencils and paper, so she'd clear away the leaves, and I'd draw letters in the dirt with a stick, or use a piece of charcoal on the smooth side of some birch bark. Other times she'd have me study tree branches and find V's and W's, or press an acorn cap into mud to show me the shape of an O. Then she had me pick out words in Little House on the Prairie, and then whole sentences. Pretty soon I could read the book on my own, although I still liked it best when Ma read to me. I remember plenty of scary times, too, like when lightning split a tree right beside our shelter, and the thunder was so loud I felt it in my teeth. Sometimes the scariest things were the ones you couldn't see, like wild hogs snuffling through the camp in the middle of the night, or solar bear howls in the distance. One day I happened upon the skull of a hog that had been killed by solar bears. I pried out the tusks, wedged them in one end of a split stick, and wrapped the split tight with woven runner vines. I called it my tooth club and practiced swinging it at imaginary solar bears. Even though I knew it wouldn't do me any good if a real solar bear truly wanted to eat me, carrying that tooth club made me feel a little better. I don't know how long we wandered. Maybe Dad and Ma kept track, but for me it just seemed like it was the only life we'd ever known, and that those other fuzzy memories belonged to another girl. Ma was growing skinnier. There were dark circles under her eyes. Back then, she was the sickly one, and Dad was strong and tough. Once he twisted his ankle on a rock, and it swelled up, and we didn't know if it was broken. By the next morning, it was back to its normal shape, and he could walk fine. Dad was weird that way. He was really healthy, and he healed really fast. Maybe the garlic really did work. He never got a cough or a cold. And if he got a scratch on his arm in the afternoon, by the next morning, you could hardly see where it was. I asked Ma about it once, and she just said, "Your father has a remarkable constitution. I asked her what constitution meant, and by the time she got done explaining that one, I had forgotten what I asked in the first place. We wandered for a couple of years. We moved a lot and scrounged our food from the woods. My hair grew long and tangled. I outgrew my clothes, and Ma had to patch them together with pieces torn from one of Dad's old t-shirts. Sometimes we would stay in one place for a few months. Then we'd pack everything up and move again. One day, after we had been wandering again, we were scouring the hills for wintergreen berries and windfall apples, and still more wild garlic, when we came to a sharp cut in the earth. Dad walked to the edge, peered over, and hollered, "It's a gold mine!" I ran to his side to look, and there below me I saw piles and piles of junk. Bed springs, rotting lumber, cracked rubber tires, rusty soup cans and empty oil cans, broken bottles, pipes and chunks of iron and gears from old machines, a cracked cast iron stove. This wasn't even fresh junk. It was old junk, half buried with trees and brush growing out of it. Dad clambered over the edge and started tugging at the piles like a man who just discovered a pile of loose money. "We don't have to scrounge anymore," he said. "Now we can scavenge." I remember thinking, is there a difference? Neither one sounded very thrilling. Ma was kind of hanging back. But down there in the junk, Dad was scampering around like a little kid. "Hey," he said, bending down. When he stood up, he was holding a window frame high above his head. It had all the little squares, but the glass panes were missing. "A window! For your mother!" Ma was always saying that of all the things she missed from her old life, most of all, she missed drinking tea while reading a good book beside a window. Dad scrambled back up to where Ma was standing and surveyed the scene one more time. "Gold mine gully," he declared. Then he hugged Ma. "Marlene, we're staying put." For the first time since I don't know when, Ma smiled. Then a darker look came over her face. "But John, can we? Dare we?"
"We don't really have a choice now," said Dad,
his face turning serious too. Then he noticed how closely I was watching him, and he switched quickly back to a smile.
"And what better place?"
he said, nodding toward the ravine and switching quickly back to a smile. He raised the glassless window so the sun passed through it and fell in squares at Ma's feet.
"I'll build you a cabin, with a window for reading and a bookshelf."
Of course he had no idea how he would do this, especially since he had no tools. And Dad wasn't even very good at rigging up a simple shelter with our tarp. But I could tell he was more excited than I had ever seen him, and Ma's smile returned.
"It'll be just like Little House on the Prairie," said Dad.
"You mean Little House perched over the junk pile," said Ma. But she was still smiling.
"We are staying put, kids,"
said Dad, gathering us into his arms. Over the next few weeks, we dragged enough lumber and tin out of Goldmine Gully to build a sleeping shelter. It wasn't very sturdy. Everything was just propped up and tied together with vines and woven grass and old rusty wire, and the roof was the same old tarp we'd been sleeping under when we were moving camp every day. The window Dad found was still leaned against a tree, with not a pane of glass in it. Ma had gone back to looking as tired as ever. We were always hungry. Dad would dig in the junk for a few days straight and tinker on the shelter, but then he would seem to lose interest and wander off into the woods for the rest of the day. Sometimes he didn't come back until late at night. The next morning, he was always grinning his goofy, lopsided grin and was ready to scavenge again. One day, when Dad had walked off yet again
and I could see the worry in Ma's eyes, I went for a walk of my own to think things over. I was angry. Angry with my father for wandering off. Angry with Ma for not standing up to him. Angry with both of them for making us live like wilderness hobos and not telling me why. Part of me wanted to run away. And part of me knew I had a responsibility to help my family. I guess I was learning you can love your Ma and Dad and still get angry with them sometimes. I didn't want to leave, but I wanted to be alone. I stomped off downhill from Goldmine Gully, not sure where I was headed. I didn't make it very far when I came upon that old Ford Falcon. It was half hidden behind a clump of brush and sunk into the dirt. But when I tried a door, it opened. The car smelled funky inside, but it was in pretty good shape and not all chewed up like I thought it would be. The middle seat was folded down, and there was plenty of room for me to stretch out. Looking back up the hill, I could still see our shelter. At that moment, I realized that this old car would let me hide out, but still be where I belonged. And that's when I stood up on the hood and declared myself Ford Falcon forevermore. And then I saw the old man standing in the trees. Chapter 4. He was super skinny, like a piece of beef jerky with legs. His narrow face was tan and wrinkly, and his eyes were bright as a bucket of sparks.
"Eating's gray."
I just looked at him, confused.
"Ig pay atinlay,"
he said, as if that explained everything. His voice was half yell, half laughter.
"Dow yahooin."
"Dawa?" I said. He was grinning ear to ear.
"Spitz a noonerism, a flop flip, a verbal mishmash in honor of the Reverend William Archibald Spooner. Dore is a dead nail for bass not tenor, a penniary or embroider, but still a lip in our lives."
Now my mouth just hung open. Suddenly, the man stepped forward and extended his hand, and in a completely normal voice said,
"Greetings. Name's Toad, Toadhopper. Real name, Thomas. But I was born legs first, and Daddy said I was kicking like a toad, and well, the name stuck. For 78 years now."
I reached down from the hood of the car and shook his hand. It was like grabbing a fistful of wire wrapped in leather. "My name is Ford, I said. Ford Falcon."
"So I hear," said Toad.
And although I had felt a little silly saying my new name, and even sillier knowing he'd just watched me talking to myself on the hood of a car, he didn't act like it was a silly name at all.
"I'm your neighbor," said Toad,
pointing back over one shoulder with his thumb.
"Live on the other side of the ridge down there in Hoot Holler."
"Hoot Holler?"
"Yeah, folks used to call it Owl Hollow, but that's hard to say, like you got ball bearings in your yapper. Mainly, though, I figured Hoot Holler was a lot funnier."
At this point, he giggled like a little kid. Later, I learned that he came up with the name Skullduggery Ridge, too, because in all the cowboy books he read when he was a boy, the bad guys, skullduggerers, Toad called them, always snuck in over a ridge. Arlinda told me once that she still catches Toad sometimes trying to hitch his pants and squint like a gun-slinging cowpuncher.
"You own a rooster?"
I thought I might as well ask.
"Hatchet," he said. "Named him that because his crows are all hacked off."
"That would be the one," I said. He giggled again. Then his face turned serious.
"I've been keeping an eye on you and your family since you arrived. Smelled your campfire smoke one day and tracked you up here. I figure you're good people. And I figure..."
Here he paused and looked up toward our ragged tarp shack.
"I figure you could use some help."
I just looked at him.
I figure, he said, you could use a neighbor.
I led the old man uphill to meet Ma and Dad. Ma was cooking over a smoky fire, but Dad didn't show up for a minute or two, and when he did, he came out from behind a tree, and I thought he looked pale and nervous. But in 5 minutes, Toad had them chattering like old friends. Toad had that way about him, and I think they were relieved to talk to a grown-up for a change. Later, I heard Dad talking quietly to Ma, and Ma said, if he was trouble, there'd have already been trouble. Toad told Ma and Dad that back when he was a boy, the spot we were living on was located where the property lines of four farms came together. In those days, he said, before garbage trucks and landfills, every farm had its own back 40 junk dump. And since ours had served four families for several generations, we'd find plenty of good stuff in there, if we kept digging. He also said he made regular trading trips to a nearby village named Knobbern. And if we scavenged up any iron or other useful items in Goldmine Gully, he could trade them for nails or flour or sugar or other things we might need. Later, when we learned that Toad had an entire junkyard of his own full of things to trade, we realized he certainly didn't need to lug ours to town. But at a time when we barely had two sticks to rub together, it was a big deal. Over the next few months, Toad changed our lives completely. He lent us tools and gave us lumber and helped us build a real shack, dragging everything up the long ridge behind his twin oxen, Frank and Spank. He gave us rain barrels so we didn't have to carry water or collect it in slimy plastic jugs. He brought up some cast iron pots and pans. He gave us an axe for splitting firewood. And after helping us build a coop, he gave us half a dozen chickens. He also introduced us to his wife, Arlinda. She taught Ma and me about foraging for herbs and edible plants and helped get us started with a garden. She even gave us garlic bulbs so Dad would never run out. And about every other week, she gave us one of her homemade pies, which are so big you could use one for a pillow. Before long, it seemed like we'd always known Toad and Arlinda, like they were part of the family. One or two days a week, I hiked down to help Toad. Sometimes we'd sort junk and old steel for his trips to Knobbern. Sometimes I'd help him clean his pig pens and chicken coop, or use an old scythe to cut and gather hay from the small meadow tucked up in Hoot Holler. In return, he and Arlinda gave us some of the ham and bacon they smoked, or seeds for our garden. Working with Toad was like going to school. He taught me all kinds of things, like how to use tools and repair leather, how to butcher pigs and chickens, and how to weave a rope from grass. I even got to where I could understand more and more of Toad's silly talk. Pig Latin, he taught me, is where you move the first letter, or couple of letters, to the back of the word, and then add A, as in Ig Pay Attenlay. And Reverend William Archibald Spooner was a preacher who lived in the 1800s and was known for flipping the front end of his words around in a way that wound up making them funnier, like the time he called a well-oiled bicycle a well-boiled icicle. And then sometimes Toad just invents his own rules, like saying flop-flip instead of flip-flop, or describing Reverend Spooner as door as a dead nail for bass not tenor, a penny urry, or embroider, but still a lip in our lives. If you study it out, you will see he is using bass not tenor instead of low, which sounds the same as low, or penny urry instead of cent shurry, and a lip in our lives instead of alive in our lips. Oh, an embroider is a synonym for sew, which is a homonym for sew. In other normal words, the Reverend William Archibald Spooner, dead as a doornail, for lo, a century or so, but still alive in our lips. Mr. Toad,
I said one day when I got to know him better.
You talk weird. I just lang love you-age, said Toad, grinning like Christmas.
I said, wouldn't know it the way you treat it.
He laughed and laughed.
Chapter 5.
Crock-a-doodle! Ack, cack, cack, cack.
Breakfast is finished. Dad and I are down in Goldmine Gully digging in the damp, mossy earth. Hatchet is still at it.
Admit it, you miss that bird, says Dad.
I roll my eyes and Dad grins. Hatchet the rooster and I do not get along. The last time I went down to help Toad clean his pig shed, that bird came after me like I'd been dipped in lard and rolled in seeds. Those peck marks on my kneecaps? Hatchet. The claw scratches on my forearms? Hatchet. I pat the spit stick slung over my shoulder. The only way I'd miss that rooster is if I didn't aim straight, I say. Dad chuckles and goes back to digging. After his slow start, Dad is having a good day. It's good when Dad's happy, and I've learned to enjoy it because I know eventually he'll get hollow-eyed and cranky, and then he'll disappear again. I asked him about it once.
Now and then I just need some time alone, he said.
And then he turned and walked away like he didn't want to talk about it. Like he needed some time alone. Today, though, the sun is shining, and it matches our mood. Even though we're basically digging through trash, it still feels like a treasure hunt. You never know what you'll find. Mostly it's pretty unexciting. Rotten wood, rusty soup cans, worthless plastic. But sometimes you find a pail with only a tiny hole in it, or a spoon that isn't bent, or maybe a chunk of iron Toad can trade for bags of oatmeal and brown sugar. One time I unearthed a cast iron wheel still attached to its axle. Toad said it was from an old haystacker. Rather than trade it in Auburn, Toad used it to rig up a device that allows Ma to adjust the heat on her cooking cauldron by turning the wheel to raise and lower it over the fire. Another time I discovered a faded red plastic dinner plate that was rounded on the bottom and wouldn't really sit flat. Dad saw me puzzling over it and grinned.
Go stand up by the shack, he said, taking it from my hand.
Then he flipped it over and sailed it through the air right into my hands. And that was the day I learned to play frisbee. The first thing I dug up today was some clear plastic sheeting. It's still carefully folded in its original wrapper. This is a big discovery because we can use the plastic to build miniature greenhouses. We call them hoop houses for the garden. We don't get winter like we used to, but there are enough snap blizzards and freeze blasts to put the earth through herky-jerky seasons that can catch us by surprise, so much of the garden has to be kept under plastic. Also, until Dad finds more window panes, our shack windows are made of plastic sheeting, just like this. They're nothing like glass, but they keep out most of the rain and let in some of the light. We could survive without scavenging in Goldmine Gully, but we would be a lot skinnier and a lot more miserable. The things we dig up help us fill the gaps when we trade them for things we can't grow or make ourselves, and sometimes for things just to put a little brightness in our lives.
Hey, says Dad.
He's been working very carefully, scraping at the dirt and brushing it away with an old paintbrush, like he's an archaeologist looking for fossils. His careful work has paid off, because there before him is a complete pane of glass. Dirty, but without a single chip or crack. We find a lot of glass, but most of it is broken. In fact, as a scavenger, you learn pretty early never just to paw around in the dirt. Besides broken glass, we uncover a lot of sharp tin and old nails. One careless move and you're missing half a finger, and you can't just trot off to a hospital to get it fixed. That glass pane would be valuable in Auburn, but I know Dad won't give it up. He's been collecting them ever since we started digging, all in hopes of giving Ma her reading window.
Only 6 more to go,
he says with a big lopsided smile.
Dad carefully wraps the pain in some rags and tucks it into his work pack. He's still smiling as I turn back to dig again. But just as I'm reaching out with my digging stick, I spy what looks like a tiny pink mouse ear protruding from the hillside. I brush the dirt away, and there, looking right back at me, is a small, round pig face. His eyes are wide, and his mouth is open, and I can see the pale blue bill of a cap set back on his round head, which is about the size of a crabapple.
Oh, I say, like a kid who sees a pretty rock, and forgetting everything I've learned, drive my hand straight into the dirt. Immediately, a sharp pain shoots up the side of one finger. Sure enough, I've sliced it on a splinter of glass. I flex my finger quickly to make sure it still works, and it does, but it's bleeding pretty good. Now, just to be safe, I'll have to go back to the shack to wash it out and wrap some of Ma's poultice strips around it. First, though, more carefully now, and using my digging stick instead of my fingers, I pry the pig free and hold it up so Dad can see it.
Wow, says Dad. Porky pig.
I just look at him. I have no idea what he's talking about. From the cartoons, he says. Sometimes Dad forgets I wasn't raised in his world. The last time I saw a cartoon, I was tiny, and I certainly don't remember this pig being in any of them. I hand him the statue. He grabs it carefully because some of my blood has dripped on it, then brushes away some of the dirt and turns the pig face up again.
Porky changed a lot over the years. This version looks like the Porky who was popular when my parents were children. You'll get a pretty penny for this in Auburn. And speaking of pennies, look here.
Dad points to a slot in the back of the pig's head.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.